So, good afternoon. I think people are getting ready for lunch, so bear with two more sessions. I'll try to make it faster so that I don't bore you with my talk. So, a few years back, we were working for a product, and it's an e-commerce product. We're building a module for designing things online. So the idea was you can design things using your browser and print it on your goodies, okay? And it's very common, but so the users can come to the site, design things and say that, okay, this is what I want, and that needs to be printed on the goodies, and then they can pay it, and then the design is delivered to the printing vendors, and then they deliver, the things get delivered to the customer. And they can do multiple things. They can upload their own images and resize it, add their own text, add different kinds of shapes and so on and so forth. And it was working well. That is when we realized that we have a problem. That is, we wanted to introduce the functionality to for certain text transformation. It's not exactly transformation, text features such as rotating the text or adding shadows to the text, stuff like that. And that is when we realized that the library that we are using for converting the design that you see on the UI to the PDF, that it was not very precise. It has to be very precise. The colors and the position has to be very precise so that the printers can print it very well, so that it does exactly look like how do you see on the site. It gets printed exactly like that on the goodie. So we hit with a bottleneck at certain transformations were not working as we expected. And that's a huge change. And so we have two problems here. One is that the current library doesn't support the feature that we want to introduce. And we want to release that feature as soon as possible. The next problem is that we already have a lot of features built using the existing library. And then we also need to migrate that functionality to the new library. So what we did was the immediate requirement or what business wants is to deliver the new functionality. So what we did was we approached it using a concept called or a technique called parallel change. So what it does is that we have both libraries sitting in the code base. The existing functionality uses the existing library. And for the new features that we are adding, where we had the issue, we used the new library. So this is the parallel change. And over a period of time, we migrated from the existing, the old library to the new one. And that gave us enough time to test the new library rather than going into a branch and doing the entire migration, coming back and releasing and hit with surprises. This gave us enough time to evaluate the new library so that we don't hit with another surprise down the line. Okay, and this is not a very new technique. This is called the standard branch by abstraction. So don't branch the repository, instead branch your code. Okay, and over a period, as you gain confidence, you migrate it. And then how long the parallel implementation should be there, it depends on a lot of factors. Okay, and things moved on. Now I work for a product called Good Karma. It's a product that is delivered to yoga studios. It's a B2B product for yoga studios to manage their business. And so we started, it's still a startup. We started 12 to 18 months back. And so the product is evolving. And we started with certain idea. Then as we onboard new customers or we learn from the market, we realize that, okay, there are changes. And that means the changes needs to happen even to our database models. Okay, so because of the, as the product grows, the understanding has to reflect on the product as well as on the modelings that you have done on the databases. So, and you know that database is considered, even if you are a startup, if you don't have millions of customers, even then, the slowest moving part of your product is database. And that is considered as a very high risk thing, because if something goes wrong, it is very scary, especially on the database side, migrations and stuff like that. It's very complicated, and there's high tendency to become very nervous when the database doesn't work as expected. So can we, the thought process is, can we actually make it less risky? And that's the whole premise of continuous delivery. If there is something that pains, do it all the time so that your pain gets reduced. It's not, the solution is not to do that. Solution is actually do it all the time so that you don't have, you take the pain forward and do it continuously rather than doing it once in a while, right? And that is where the concept of database refactoring comes into picture. And the key word here is refactoring. The refactoring, as per what Martin Fowler has explained, the beauty of refactoring is that you do it in small steps. You do a series of small steps refactoring, which gives you a bigger result. And that every refactoring that you do has to be split into small tasks. Okay, as small as possible. And that is the value of refactoring if you do it in the actual way. And similar things can be applied for databases too. Okay, and that is what I learned during the last few months, or say even close to a year. So there are techniques. None of these techniques are mine. There is a book called Database Refactoring. It talks about how do you structure each migration depending upon what kind of migration you want to do, right? Is it are you adding a new validation? Or are you changing the structure of the database? Or are you adding new indexes? How do you approach each of this is very well written in that book. And I'll take up two examples that I've used recently while building the product. So this is called the split column refactoring. What it does is, so the product has a concept of, has a module for booking, online booking of trial classes. That is, the customers can come to, they get an SMS to a certain, with a link. Then using an IVR system, they go to that site and then they can book a trial class with any yoga studio. Okay, completely automated. And what we need to know is that whether the customer has attended the class, and that is not where the funnel ends, right? Funnel ends if they become a member of the yoga studio. So first they book, get the SMS, that's the first step. Then they book a class, then they attend the trial, and then they become a member. And that's a success criteria of the entire thing, right? So we had a status field in our trial bookings table, and the status field states whether they have attended or not, along with the status saying that, okay, have they registered? Okay, so it can be they attended, but they are not ready to, they are not interested in registering now, or it can be that I don't want to register now, I want to register a few months down the line. Then there has to be a follow-up mechanism, right? So both these fields together were stored in this particular field, which we realized over a period of time that, okay, we need to split it, and so that we can run better analysis on that and then give more insights to our customers. And that is when we had to split it, and we called it as attendance status and membership status. First, attendance status says whether they attended or not. If they have not attended, membership status may not make much sense, but that is not mandatory. Even without attending it, they can still become a member. And so what we did was, we introduced new fields, still kept the old field, and apart from that, introducing the field, we also added certain triggers, or say even every ORM supports callbacks, so that anytime when you save the data to status, it has to split and store to these two fields. Okay, so this is the first step, that you migrate to the new implementation, and then there are as part of the code base or even other dependencies that you have, they depend on this field. So it takes time to actually change everything across, right? And even how do you display on the field, how do you display on the UI, or say even other downstream dependencies that you have which uses the same field. So it takes time, right? So you can leave it like that for some time, and then until all the downstream dependencies are moved to the new implementation, and then you contract it to the new implementation. So this is the entire refactoring process. You introduce the migration, That is a transition period. And at the end of it, you contract it to the new implementation. And rather than doing it as a first one step, you're doing it in multiple steps. Okay. So another example is split table, where in this case, instead of splitting into multiple columns, we are splitting into multiple tables. So we had billing cycles, which had all the payment details. We wanted to segregate it because later we realized that, okay, one, people can pay in installments. So one, in when they are paying, they can say, okay, I'll pay it now. After a month, I'll pay the rest of the amount. So it has to be tracked in multiple tables. One billing cycle can have multiple payments. So we had to segregate that. The same technique, we introduced triggers to save to the new table. We changed the across the application to use the new structure, and then you move, completely move to the new one. Okay, so the same thing, you have a migration time, and then you completely switch back, and that is where the entire process is called expand. You expand to the new way, and then you contract, completely get rid of the old way of doing it. And so what is required for you to implement it? What is the basics that you need so that you can always approach this? One is the versioning. You need to have versioning for all your database migrations. Every migration has to be uniquely identified. And as far as I know, I might be wrong in this case, but I think almost all the ORM frameworks supports, especially those follow the active record model, supports a migration way so that you can quickly roll back or say move forward or roll back to a certain state of a migration. That's a basic. Need enough automated tests as safety nets to make sure that, okay, none of the changes are breaking, especially when you are transitioning and contracting. Okay, this gives you enough confidence. And then the last is, how long it can take for a team to actually contract, and that completely depends on various factor. I've been a consultant, so I'll say it depends, right? So it depends on various factors on how long you want it to be, how long the migration, how long you need the parallel change to be implemented, right? It depends on how big is the team, how much critical is the current migration, how much time, how much downstream dependencies you have, how much time you may need to keep it so that you gain enough confidence, right? Lots and lots of factors that you need to think of on. And this is not just restricted to the expand contract pattern. I think it is about how do you want to deploy database migrations, right? Do you want to have downtimes? Then how do you plan your downtimes? Or if you don't want to do a downtime, what is the other mechanism of doing it? And that's the strategy that you have to build. And this is not this entire idea of parallel change or expand contract pattern is about lowering the risks of every release, right? I mean, that's the whole idea. How can you bring down the risk that every deployment, every release is risky? But that doesn't mean that we can't release, right? But you can only reduce that by doing it and by taking care of certain things. And what are those principles? One is doing it incremental, rather than doing it in a completely, taking it as steps itself is the first step. And then making sure that any change that you're doing is actually ready to deploy. That making sure that every commit has enough confidence that you can build that, okay, if it goes to production, it doesn't break anything. So automated tests and other things helps you in this case. And so you can actually, you don't have to, every deployment doesn't have to be resulting in releases, right? For example, in the case of a migration, we had actually migrated the database, but the user interface or it is not visible to the users that, okay, new changes have been built into the system, right? And then that is called the idea of dark launching. When you are just deploying as a migration, it is called the dark launching. Or even feature toggles help you in this case. You can turn off that feature in certain environments because of various reasons. You are not ready for doing that. And So decoupling, having enough mechanism to decouple every deploy from release helps you to lower the risk of your deployments. And doing it in small batches, as small as possible, right? And that's very, very important. Without that, I think the rest of the things will not work. And as a reference, I would highly recommend, this has a lot of techniques on how do you approach database migrations, and some more references, and that's it. Do we have time for questions? I think there's one.
So I can see the parallels between having feature flags and also doing this kind of step where you expand and then contract. So what I see happening is over time, you have a lot of code where we have things which are really not using. You have expanded but not really contracted.
Contract, yeah.
So how do you, so the issue is like you have to remember to keep track of it. So how do you do that as part of your planning process? I mean, how do you kind of do the issue tracking for those kind of things? I think it becomes very important because if you don't have, do it right,
yes,
it kind of becoming, code being really, really messy.
Yes. So that is the reason I emphasized on the strategy. Okay, so what is the approach that you want to take? What is the guideline that as a team you want to follow, right? The same goes with, it can be, same goes with feature toggles also. You can say that no feature toggles can exist in the code base beyond 2 weeks. If the entire team agrees that, okay, that's a good time frame, then you may need to bring in systems so that it is automatically detected. Or you may have to bring in some kind of system to know that, okay, there are certain toggles which are existing beyond this time. So we had used our own backlog kind of thing for feature toggles and this kind of changes to make sure that, okay, you don't, it's tracked separately. But interestingly, I've heard that there are tools, automated tools that certain teams built. I've never tried that to check the code, say for, if it is for feature toggles, it checks how many toggles are there. And then it, if there are certain toggles which beyond the expiry time, then it fails the build. So you can go to that level. So there will be some kind of a guideline that every team follows for either for expand contract or feature toggle. Then you can look for that patterns and then have automated systems to fail it. That is very great, but I've never tried that. But having a backlog of yourself and then keep monitoring it, when in the normal team meetings or daily stand-ups, bringing that every once in a while might, after a while, what I've seen is that it settles down in the team, right? If you bring it very consistently, then I think over a period of time, it becomes a habit for the team.
More questions? Okay, thanks,
okay.
Leena.
Thank you.